Good morning and welcome to Open Door Online. My name is Noemia Schelling. We're so glad that you are here with us today. If you are a first-time guest, would you text the word new to the number on your screen? We have a little gift that we'd like to send you in the mail. And if you haven't already downloaded the church app, you'll want to do that today. There's a lot of resources on there for you and your family, and it will connect you also to our calendar and our church events. So download that today and enjoy the service.
everyone go ahead and pray with me? Lord, you are the source of all our true and everlasting joy. We praise you for the power which is beyond our comparative knowledge. We worship you for your wisdom which is beyond our understanding. You meet all our needs, you restore the brokenhearted, and you heal all the wounded. You have revealed yourself to your people and are building your church against which the hate, the gates of hell can never prevail. Lord, fill our hearts with love as we sing your praises through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Well, good morning. You can be seated for a minute. We wanted to start off a little bit different. I'm going to come teach from back here today because I don't want to be exposed to anybody or anything. I'm just kidding. We actually have some baptisms that we're going to do this morning. So very exciting. Yes. Who's first? Come on, buddy. All right. Remind me of your name. All right. Joseph, you've trusted the Lord as your personal Savior?
Yes.
Awesome. Well, then, my brother, on your profession of faith in Him, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Put your hands up like this. There we go. Buried in the likeness of His death and raised to walk in newness of life. Awesome job, buddy. Awesome. Who's next? Go, come right on around and sit down. There you go. Remind me of your name. Charlie, you've trusted the Lord as your personal Savior?
Yes.
Awesome. Then on your profession of faith in Him, my sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lift your arms up. Buried in the likeness of His death and raised to walk in newness of life. Carrie, you've trusted the Lord as your personal Savior?
Yes.
Awesome. Then on your profession of faith in Him, my sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lift your hands up for me. Buried in the likeness of His death and raised to walk in newness of life. Very good. It is warm. Very good. Remind me of your name. Christine, you've trusted the Lord as your personal Savior?
Yes, I have.
Awesome. Then on your profession of faith in Him, my sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of His death. And raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. That's awesome. Are you ready? Remind me of your name.
Ava.
Can you see her? There you go, Ava. Ava, you've trusted the Lord as your personal Savior?
Yes.
Awesome, sweetheart. Then on your profession of faith in Him, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the likeness of His death, and raised to walk in newness of life. Good job, sweetie. Emily, you've trusted the Lord as your personal Savior?
Yes.
Awesome. Then on your profession of faith in Him, my sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of His death, and raised to walk in newness of life. It is. Remind me of your name.
Jane,
you've trusted the Lord as your personal Savior?
Yes.
Awesome. Then on your profession of faith in Him, my sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of His death, and raised to walk in newness of life. You good? What a way to start off a Sunday morning, isn't it? That's exciting. We're going to have a few more songs.
Church.
Oh, there's nothing.
nothing better than him. Amen? Now, this next song that we're worshiping with really stands out to me in a lot of ways, but one of them in particular is it really speaks to the simplicity and power of speaking at Jesus' great and powerful name. The scripture, Ephesians 4:29 through 32 says, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you." When I hear that scripture, I'm reminded of the importance of building each other up with the Word of God and not letting ourselves get caught up in the bitterness and anger that life can so often throw at us. And when we speak His Word, we speak it at the sound of His great name. And that's such a powerful message that can reach so many people. The lost are saved, the condemned are shamed, the fear has to leave, and that's all at the sound of His great name. There are so many new methodologies and so many ways that churches are changing to evolve with culture, but the true message never changes, and that's His great and powerful name. So sing along with this next one with us.
Son of God and man, you are.
That was... So those lyrics, it's unbelievable. You know, you get lyrics sometimes that just kind of hit you and cut you a little deeper than you thought they might, and that's certainly one of them. I don't know about you, but I'm ready to see Jesus come back. But those words say, it's like God speaking right at you. It's like he grabs your face and he's like, that Jesus guy, he's the most holy, he's the most worthy, and he's the most deserving. So Ecclesiastes 9:10 says, whatever you do, do well. For when you go to the grave, there will be no work or planning or knowledge or wisdom. Reflecting back on that this week, I find it really, truly, truly fascinating that when you look at each individual up on this stage and each individual that comes up on this stage every week, they could be out doing something else. They could be somewhere else and not participating here or in another church. They have enough talent to go wherever they want. I mean, look what just happened here. It's amazing. But what amazes me is the ability to touch enough lives to want to be a part of worship. So we've got a new member up here this week. Bailey Sherrill. And that's special for us. It's when you hear that someone wants to be a part of what you're doing and do it for God, that's paramount for why we do this every single week. Now everyone up here chooses to give their best to God, whether it's running the slides, which a lot of people don't realize there's a lot that goes on that you don't see. You run the slides. We have someone always running the sound. Whether it's piano, 12-string bass, drums again, electric, to all the singers up here, everyone's up here because God put them here. And their goal every single week is to give their best. They can look at Ecclesiastes and say, that's what we're doing. Now their goal, and I think all of us can attest to this, that every time we're up here, we want to give it our best. Because worship to us is what helps fill that void. We love the preaching. We love the worship. We love the song. But to worship on the deepest of levels, not just a deep level, but the deepest of levels, so we can all have a better understanding of who Christ is. You know, God gave us his son, and he gave us his best. And when I think about that, he deserves no less from me, from you, from anyone up here on a daily basis. I give great thanks to God for arming this stage today with people that want to give God their best. I love it. I can say with confidence that everyone up here loves God and will do their best. Now, I love it that every time we decide that we want to push further or push harder or do something a little bit different, a little bit funky, everyone's response is, okay. And you can't beat that. You can't beat that will for God. But I thank God every day for the blessing of music and for the blessing of him and what he gave to us. Hope you guys can enjoy this next song. Sing along, please.
Bless you.
amen.
Good morning, guys, and welcome to Open Doors Online Campus. I'm Pastor Andy. I want to thank you so much for joining with us today. We have a great service planned for you and can't wait to get into things. But before we do, we always celebrate before we have the time where we look in God's Word. And last week, we had a great week. We had one adult who trusted Christ in the morning service. We had several guests, and we had an awesome membership class this week. And we have one of those every month. So if you'd like to learn more about becoming a member at Open Door, you can sign up for that on our website. But jumping into our story today, we're looking again at the life of David. And David is an amazing character in God's Word. He's mentioned 1,127 times, and he has over 54 chapters dedicated to just his life. This was a man that God emphasized big time in his Word. He's even known as the man after God's own heart. Man, what a testimony to have. How awesome would it be for God to say that you or I were a man or a woman after God's own heart? It's awesome. And in this section that we're going to look at today, we're going to see David as a hero. David is a hero, but we're going to look at how he was a hero and what made him a hero today. David has gone from absolute obscurity, living on the backside of the desert taking care of sheep, to now one of the most famous men in all the land. And you know, fame is a funny thing. Fame is a lot harder to deal with than success. Fame has ruined more people than failure ever could. Fame, who would have thought? I mean, you would think fame would be awesome, it'd be easy to deal with. But fame and success is so much harder and so much more dangerous than failure in our own lives. Have you ever checked out people who won the lottery? I think it's kind of cool to look up their lives. I don't play the lottery, but I've watched some of their lives and read about it, some of them, and it's unbelievable what happens to them. I have a couple of them I want to read to you. According to the New York Daily News, 70% of lottery winners end up broke within 7 years. Some of them have even been killed because of their winnings. A man named Abraham Shakespeare, age 47, won $30 million in the Florida lottery in 2009. He was shot twice in the chest sometime in April of 2009, and he wasn't even reported missing until November of 2009. His body was found under a slab of cement in a backyard in January of 2010, all because his life was changed. Success was harder to deal with than failure. Another man, David Edwards, was unemployed when he won part of a $280 million lottery jackpot in 2001. Edwards lost all of his money in just a few years and ended up living in a storage unit surrounded by human feces. Success can be so much harder to deal with than failure. And the stories go on and on and on. But because becoming famous, it doesn't fix all of our problems. In fact, it just creates a whole bunch of new ones for us. So we have to be careful with success. And that's what happens here in our story with David. I want us to look at it together. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 5 says, "Whatever Saul asked David to do, David did it successfully." I want you to mark that word successfully, and I want you to remember it because we're going to talk about it as we go. David did it successfully. "So Saul made him a commander over the men of war and appointed that he was welcomed by the people and Saul's officers alike. When the victorious Israelite army was returning home after David had killed the Philistine, women from all over the towns of Israel came to meet King Saul. They sang and danced for joy with tambourines and cymbals. This was their song: 'Saul has killed his thousands, and David his 10,000s. This made Saul very angry. "What is this?" he said. "They credit David with 10,000s and me with only thousands? Next, they'll be making him their king." Verse 9, "So from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. Then the very next day, a tormenting spirit from God overwhelmed Saul, and he began to rave in his house like a madman. David was playing the harp as he did each day, but Saul had a spear in his hand and suddenly hurled it at David, intending to pin him to the wall. But David escaped him twice. Saul was then afraid of David, for the Lord was with David and had turned away from Saul. Finally, Saul sent him away and appointed him commander over 1,000 men, and David faithfully led his troops into battle. David continued to succeed." There's that word succeed again, successful and succeed. Mark it. We're going to talk about it. "David continued to succeed in everything he did, for the Lord was with him. When Saul recognized this, he became even more afraid of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David because he was so successful." There's that word a third time. "He was so successful at leading his troops into battle." Let's pray, and then we're going to talk about David being a hero and what really made David a hero. Lord, I love you so much, and thank you for each one of those who have taken time out of their busy day to spend some time looking into your word, joining with us online so that we can draw closer to you. Lord, I pray that no matter where we're at, no matter what's going on in our lives, that you would help us to slow down for a few minutes and to focus in on what your word has to say and how we can put it into practice in our own lives so we can draw closer to you. We love you, Father, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. There are two circumstances in life that really bring out people's true character. One is when they have to be confronted or corrected. When you confront someone or correct someone, you really see their true character. The second time is when they're given authority. When a person is promoted or given authority, it brings out their true character. David has risen through the ranks. He's been promoted to a very important man. He's been given quite a lot of authority in the nation, and he handled it very, very wisely. You know, if I was sitting in your home with you right now, or sitting on the boat with you right now, or wherever you're at, I kind of wish I was on the boat with you right now, but if I was sitting right across from you, and we were face to face, and I looked at you and said, "Are you a Christian?" What would you say to me? Most people would probably say, "Yes, I'm a Christian," and you would proceed to tell me your testimony about how you became a Christian, how you put your faith and trust in Jesus, and you came into a relationship with Jesus. And we do that usually every week with our stories of grace. We didn't have one this week, and we have a great opportunity for some of you to get involved and to share your story. So if you'd like to share your story, if God's been working in your heart to share how you came into a relationship with Jesus, email me and let me know so we can get you lined up to be able to do that. But that would be our testimony. What happened? How did I come to Christ? And most of you would probably do that. But what if I changed that question a little bit and didn't ask you, "Are you a Christian?" But what if I asked you, "Do you always act like a Christian?" Boy, that one kind of gets you right down in here, doesn't it? Because the truth of the matter is, we don't always act like a Christian. Even if we are a believer, sometimes we don't act the way we should act. And as we read through this section of David's life, we see a major theme, and that is that David was successful. The phrase is used here, successful, can be translated a different way, and to be behave wisely or to act wisely is another way that it could be translated or said. So David was successful, David behaved wisely, David acted wisely. And God bringing success many times, not all the time, but many times, is determined by how we act and how we behave. David behaved and he acted wisely. Proverbs chapter 9 verse 10 says, "Fear of the Lord is the foundation of wisdom." The fear of the Lord is the foundation of wisdom. When we behave wisely is when God has his proper place in our lives. When I have a true fear of God, when God is sitting on the throne, when he has his proper place in my life, that is when I begin to exhibit wisdom. And the opposite's true as well. When God is not in his proper place in our lives, we act the opposite of wise, which is what? A fool. The Bible says in Psalm 14, verse 1, "Only fools say in their heart, there is no God." Well, most of us wouldn't say, "I don't believe in God." We would never come out and say that out loud, but our lives scream it sometimes by the way that we live. Just the things that we do each day can say, "I'm not a believer, I'm not a Christian, I don't want any part of that." So we have to be very careful in the way that we live our lives. Because when God is in his proper place, we're going to be honest people. When God is in his proper place, we're going to have a clean heart. When God is in his proper place, we're going to have a clean mouth. The reason God brought success to David is because God was in the proper place in David's life. One of the most obvious ways to tell if God is in the proper place in our life is by examining our attitude. This is a tough one. Attitude is a scary thing for us to examine because we don't always have the best attitude, do we? And the thing with attitude is no one, I mean no one, has power over my attitude except me. I'm the only one who controls my attitude. I can't control what people say about me. I can't control what people do to me. But what I can control is how I respond and my attitude about those things. You see, Saul faced the same test and he failed it miserably. David, although, passed with flying colors. Why? Because God was in his rightful place in David's life. If we could get this one thing right, it would completely change our lives. It would completely radicalize the way that we live our Christian lives. Everything would be different. If we would just spend time every day with God and in his word and in prayer and put God into his rightful place, our entire lives would be different. Because we have to understand, God sees us. We have to understand, God hears us. We have to know that God knows our thoughts. And did you ever think about God knows every single detail about your life and about my life? He knows everything, the intents, why we do what we do. He knows everything. And because David had God in his rightful place, David acted wisely in his life. I want us to look at how David acted with people in this section of his life. Look at verse 5. Whatever Saul asked David to do, David did it successfully. So Saul made him a commander over the men of war, an appointment that was welcomed by the people and Saul's officers alike. They were excited. The people that David served with were excited that he was promoted in this way. And David was successful. That word successful that's used there means to be prudent, to be circumspect, to wisely understand, to prosper. David acted wisely. And that's the first thing that I want us to see is David's dealings with others. How did a hero deal with others? Well, David behaved wisely with the other servants of Saul. It's so easy for a little bit of success to go straight to our head. We begin to believe our own press. We begin to think that what we are is better than what we actually are. And David has seen a lot of success as a young man. He was given a new title as a leader over all these people. He was given a title. You know what titles mean? They really don't mean a whole lot. I mean, it doesn't mean much. What's more important than a title is our character. Our character is far more important than any title that we could ever hold. Character actually means something. And when we focus more on our standing with others and less about our standing with God, we're in serious trouble. When we're worried about the way other people think about us and not so much the way God thinks about us, you and I are in serious, dangerous place in our lives. We shouldn't be living for the audience of everyone. We should be living for the audience of one, and that's God. Now, what I'm not saying that we shouldn't have an org chart or shouldn't have anybody overseeing or supervising others. I am saying that many people, when they become a manager or a position of authority or given the title, they struggle with pride, and especially when they get a little bit of power. What we have to realize, though, is the world doesn't revolve around you, and the world does not revolve around me. The focus of my life should not be Andy, and the focus of your life should not be you. It should be on Christ. He should be the central focus of our life. It can even spill over into church. If people have the attitude that this is their church and that things have to be just the way that they like it, when that happens, the whole church is impacted by one person's pride. Christ should be the center of our church. Your opinion and your preferences, they really don't matter. And by the way, neither do mine. My opinions and my preferences really don't matter. This is not my church. This is not your church. This is Christ's church. He shed his blood and paid for it. This belongs to him. It's his. The only opinion that matters is his. What does Christ, what does Jesus want for his church? David wasn't that kind of a person where he was always complaining and wasn't looking down or allowing pride to go to his head. Why? Because God had his proper place in David's life, and he was wise in his dealings with others. Verse 6, when the victorious Israelite army was returning home after David had killed the Philistine, and here's the second thing I want us to see, our hero, his dealings with success. See, we've seen how a hero deals with others. Now, how does a hero deal with success? David just came back from the battle with Goliath. And everyone is thinking about one thing as they see David. There's the dude that killed the giant warrior, the greatest warrior in history. And now David has to deal with some success and some fame in his life. It would have been so easy for David to believe his own press and to believe what people are saying and to think that everything that they were saying was true about him, that he was great and that all these things, that it'd be so easy for him to do that. But we have to stay humble, especially when God is blessing. It's so easy for a little bit of success to go to our head. You know, I love to walk around the church and to pray. It keeps my mind focused on what I'm doing. And while I'm walking around the building, I'm usually, especially in the auditorium, I see paper or different things that are laying around. And I pick them up and I throw them away, or I'll clean things up as I'm walking around, pick up paper towels in the restroom, those kind of things, because I want our church to look nice. I pick up trash out in the parking lot. Whenever I see it, I try to make our church look beautiful. And I do it because it's what we're supposed to do. I want guests to be able to come into our building and to be able to see a nice, clean place. And if I ever get to the point in my life where I'm too big to unclog a toilet or pick up some paper or clean up something, then I'm in trouble. If I'm too big to do that, then there's something wrong. And if we ever get too big to help clean up or to move furniture, or we do communion once a month and we have these little cups and they have two spots that you have to peel back. And the first one is usually stuck together. So every single month when we do communion, I take every single one of those communion cups and crease that top piece back and put it in. Every single one of them I have to do by hand so that it makes it easy for people to open those up. It's just something that I do to help serve and to make things easy for our folks when they do communion. But if I ever get too big to do that, I'm in trouble. Some people would say, well, that's not my job to do those things. Those are menial tasks. I don't get paid to do that. It's not my job. But being a servant is all of our jobs. As I said before, success causes more casualties than failure. We can be a manager at work, but we're no better than the people that we manage. We might be a leader in our community, but we're no better than the other folks who live there. We might be a leader in our church, but we're no better than the other folks who walk through those doors. They have families. They have children. They have bills to pay. They have the same needs that you and I do. None of us is any better than anyone else. And David, our hero, knew that, and he dealt with fame very wisely. Look at verse 6. When the victorious Israelite army was returning home after David had killed the Philistine, women from all the towns of Israel came out to meet King Saul. They sang and danced for joy with tambourines and cymbals. This was their song: Saul has killed his thousands and David his 10,000s. You see, we've seen how our hero David dealt with others. We've seen how a hero deals with fame. Now we're seeing how a hero deals with a fool, and that is King Saul. The women came out of the city welcoming the warriors home. They heard about the battle. They came out singing and dancing because they heard about the great victory that was won. And Saul heard what was being sung. He started listening to the songs that the women are singing. As he listened, he gave a foothold to Satan in his life. And as a believer, we can't give Satan any opportunity or any place in our life. But Saul listened and he let the praise that they were giving to David take hold inside of him and start to eat him from the inside out with jealousy. They're bragging on David, and they're not bragging on me. Verse 8 says, this made Saul very angry. What's this? He said. They credit David with 10,000s and me with only thousands. Next, they'll be making him their king. So from time to time on Saul, from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. And the very next day, a tormenting spirit from God overwhelmed Saul. God allowed an evil, tormenting spirit to come on Saul. And how did Saul respond to this evil, tormenting spirit? The end of verse 10 says, but Saul had a spear in his hand, and he suddenly hurled it at David, intending to pin him to the wall, but David escaped him twice. Two different times, King Saul, the warrior king, had a spear, and he was very skilled with it, and he picked the spear up and threw it at David, trying to kill David because of the jealousy that he had in his heart. And both times, David was delivered. And before we get too hard on Saul, we can do the same things in our lives. Let me ask you, have you ever done something, or have you ever said something even if it's just in a moment of anger that you wish you could take back. Oh, I shouldn't have done that. Oh, I shouldn't have said that. Oh, I shouldn't have acted that way. We don't know whether Saul ever felt that way. The Bible doesn't tell us that he did. But have you? I know I have. I've acted out of anger. And Saul tried two different times to kill David because of the anger that he had. But what happened? Verse 11 says, but David escaped him twice. Verse 12, Saul was then afraid of David, for the Lord was with David. He had turned away from Saul. Saul was afraid. He knew the only way he could have missed twice is that God was protecting David. He should have already known this. He just watched David, this young man, charge down into a valley and do battle with a giant and win. He should have known God was on David's side. He should have seen that God was protecting David. And here's an important lesson. David could have grabbed that spear, turned it around, and threw it right back and killed King Saul. Did he? No, he didn't. It's David behaved wisely. It's a natural response for us to want to defend ourselves. It's normal to want to attack someone who attacks us. If someone tries to hurt us, we want to reach out and hurt them. If they talk about us, we want to talk about them. We face this in our marriages. We face this with our kids. We face this at work. And we even have to face this sometimes at church. Because a lot of people who claim to be Christians don't act very Christian sometimes. Why? Because God doesn't have his proper place in our lives. David handled himself wisely. The king tried to kill him, but David never responded. He just simply walked away. And all of us have difficult situations and difficult people that we have to deal with, but the question is, are we dealing with them wisely? When someone wants to fight with us, let's pray for them. When someone wants to attack us, we should be praying for them. When someone tries to hurt us, we should stop and pray for them. When someone talks about us, we should pray for them. I have a friend who says, you can talk about me all you please, but I'll talk about you on my knees. And that's the way we should be as believers. When people attack, come at us, we should be going to our knees and praying for them. We could spare ourselves a lot of heartache and a lot of pain if we would just act like a Christian should act. David was a hero. It was a hero who dealt wisely with others. He was a hero who dealt wisely with success and fame. And he was a hero who dealt wisely with a fool. That's what truly made David a hero. Not necessarily that he defeated Goliath, but that God had his proper place in his life. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you so much for your word and for this story. Help us to be a hero like David. Help us to deal wisely with others. Help us to deal wisely with success and with fame if it comes to us. And help us to deal wisely with fools, because there's a lot of them. Help us to deal wisely with every situation that you bring in front of us, acting the way a Christian should act. Help us to take that step. You may be watching this morning or this afternoon or this evening, whenever it is you're watching this. And maybe you're sitting there thinking, well, that's all great and good, but how do I do that? Well, the first thing you need to do is enter into the relationship with God. That means you need to accept his free gift of salvation. Let me ask it a little different way. If you were out on the car today driving down, you know, the interstate or Leavenworth Road or parallel, wherever you're at, if you get out on the road and you were to have an accident and you didn't make it home tonight, where would you spend eternity? If you can't say heaven and know that for sure, then I can help you know how you can be sure that you can spend eternity in heaven. The Bible says there's just a couple simple things that you need to know. The first one is that we're all sinners. The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of God's standard of righteousness. What's God's standard of righteousness? It's perfection. And none of us have lived a perfect life. And because we have not lived a perfect life, there's a penalty for that. The Bible says the wages or the penalty for sin is death. And that death is not just simply dying, it's a death, it's a separation from God in a terrible place called hell. And because we've all sinned, we all have to pay that penalty, death, separation from God in hell. And if the Bible stopped there, every single one of us would have to go there. We'd all have to pay that penalty. But the Bible goes on and says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. His gift to us is eternal life. Instead of death, we're given life. And the Bible says that we accept that free gift by this. The Bible says, whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. It's a free gift, the gift of God. And He's offering it to you today, and all you have to do is ask Him for it. I'll even help you with how to ask for it. But it's more than just your words, it's your heart God's looking at. So if you mean it in your heart, you understand you're a sinner, you understand Jesus died on the cross to pay for your sins and that He rose again on the third day. You know that you can't earn salvation on your own, that it's a gift from God, and you'd like to accept that free gift for yourself today, then would you just pray with me right where you're at? No matter when you're watching this or where you're at, would you just stop for a moment and pray with me? You don't even have to pray out loud because God hears the prayer of our heart. So would you pray with me right now? Let's do it together. Dear God, go ahead and pray with me. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner, and I know I deserve to go to hell because of my sin. But thank you for dying on the cross and paying the penalty for my sins. And the best way I know how, I accept your free gift of salvation. Thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me, that is the most important decision you can ever make in your life. And I want to rejoice with you, and I want to pray for you this week. So would you take your phone right now and text the word pray to the number that's on your screen so that I can have your name and I can pray with you. I'll pray for you. I'm not going to show up at your house. I'm not going to embarrass you. I would never do anything like that to embarrass you. I just want to pray for you this week. So would you take your phone out? Do it right now, because if you don't do it right now, you're going to forget. Take your phone out right now. Text the word pray to the number that's on your screen. Most important decision you can ever make in your life. Maybe you're a believer and you need to follow the Lord in baptism. Take that step. Or join the church. Take the membership class. Or maybe you have prayer requests. Go to our website, opendoorkc.com. And you can submit those things and we'll get with you and we'll get those things set up. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'm going to come back in just a moment and I'm going to share with you some next steps for you. But I want you to know I'm praying for you. I love you. God bless you. Well, hey guys, I want to thank you so much for joining with us today online and watching the service and participating with us. I want to encourage you, if you haven't had an opportunity to give, go ahead and take care of that. You can do it on our website at opendoorkc.com. Or you can download our church app and set it up and give through there. It's only by your support can we continue to do the work of the ministry. So if you'd like to support the work that's happening here at Open Door, please consider giving this week. As we talked about a hero this week and David being a hero and how a hero is supposed to act and what a hero was supposed to do, I wanted to ask you three questions and give you three opportunities to take a next step in following the Lord. What are my next steps after hearing this message? Well, one is I can ask God to help me deal with people wisely, as David did. Again, that's what made him a hero. I could take the next step, and that is commit to memorizing Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10, that talks about the fear of the Lord being the foundation of wisdom. Or maybe I want to go all the way, and I can commit to be humble and to let God fight for me. That's a tough decision right there. When you're being attacked, when people are throwing javelins at you like they did David, David didn't fight back. He simply walked away. That's a tough one to do, but maybe God's calling you to step out in faith and to follow Him this week. If you trusted Christ as your Savior today and you prayed with me, please text pray to the number that's on your screen. If you're ready to take the next step and to be baptized and go public with your faith, you can check us out on the website at opendoorkc.com and sign up for that. We'll meet with you and talk with you about that. Or maybe you need to join the church, and we have a membership class every month here at Open Door, and you can sign up for that on the website as well, opendoorkc.com. Attending that class doesn't make you a member of the church. It just gives you information so that you can pray about it and see if this is the place that God would have for you to join. Again, I want to thank you for joining with us today. If you're a first-time guest, We thank you for joining with us. You are the reason we do this. We want to reach out to people. We want to help people take the next steps in following after Christ. That's the mission of our church, to help people know and follow Jesus. So God bless you. Have a great day. I love you, and I'll see you next week.